delighted to be co-hosting tonight's event with the East-West Psychology Program. So thanks to Craig Chalquist for conspiring with me to make this happen. It's really my delight tonight to introduce to you Dr. Lance Owens, who is a profound and insightful scholar of Jung, particularly Jung's relationship to Gnosticism. He's also a physician in clinical practice at the University of Utah, and he's also a practicing Gnostic priest. I kind of want to bring a personal element into this introduction because I came across Dr. Owens' work through synchronicity. I was doing research for my own doctoral thesis on the synchronicity of the two Red Books, Jung's Red Book and J.R.R. Tolkien's Red Book of Westmarch. And I was delighted and affirmed to find that there was another person who had noticed there might be a connection at some level between these two Red Books. Dr. Owens has a wealth of material, lectures, essays, available on his website, gnosis.org. And these are primarily on Jung, his Red Book, Jung's relationship to Gnosticism, the myth of Sophia, and other very rich material. However, the first lectures I heard of Dr. Owens were a three-part series on Tolkien and the imagination. As a lifelong devotee of Tolkien myself, what struck me most about Dr. Owens was how he approached Tolkien's world, Middle Earth. He approached it from the inside. This is actually surprisingly rare among Tolkien scholars, where they kind of enter into Tolkien's world and view it from within that realm. So Dr. Owens speaks not of fiction or a made-up world, but of fairy, which is Tolkien's name for the world of the imagination. And he speaks of it as a real place. I felt that Dr. Owens takes Tolkien's world as seriously as Tolkien himself took it. So meanwhile, Dr. Owens has also taught multiple courses on Jung at the University of Utah. In 2013, he taught a course on Jung and the Gnostic tradition at the Jung Institute in Zurich, Switzerland. And since Jung's Red Book was published in 2009, Dr. Owens has published five major historical studies that are focused on Jung, Jung's Red Book, and Jung's Gnostic vision. So tonight, he will be speaking to us about Jung, Tolkien, and the hermeneutics of vision. Please help me welcome Dr. Lance Owens.
Let me just start with a shout out to Becca. The stuff she has done on the Red Book of Jung and the Red Book of Tolkien is excellent. One of her presentations that was done right here, right? Maybe a year ago, is available on YouTube. If you haven't seen it, see it. It's good. Okay. So I was... This microphone's a little bit intimidating. I'm used to using a lapel mic, and I tend to wander, so I'll try to stay more centered than I usually am for tonight. So I'm grateful to be invited to address this transdisciplinary forum. As I was just saying before we got started, in our own studies, we sometimes get so far down our own caves, our own lines of inquiry, and lost in our own forests, and forces too, I suppose, psychic and real, that it gets lonely. And it's really nice to come out to seek dialogue, not in our idiolects or in our syntax or our study, but to rise up into a dialogue, a semantics of understanding and meaning with other people. And so I thank you for the opportunity. But of course, each of us who comes to a transdisciplinary forum comes from a discipline. We have our language, we have our history. And I come to you tonight as a physician and an historian. And those two things really are linked up. The art of the physician is in part an art of history. Physicians are students of a peculiar kind of history, the history of what happens to human beings, the events of nature suffered by bodies, by minds, by psyches, by souls. They all are part of the pathology that brings people to a physician. And every physician has heard at some point in their training that the most important part of making a diagnosis, of understanding why somebody has come for you, well, it's history. In fact, some people say there are three keys, and they are history, history, and history. Sometimes you have to listen, and listen, and listen, until you hear, or until the person you're listening to is able to give you the keys. In the listening to history, we look for patterns, patterns of understanding, maybe patterns of pathology, or perhaps patterns of health. There are those too. And as an ER doctor over the last, more than 35 years now, I have figured out that I've seen over 100,000 patients. I've heard lots of stories. You know, most of it falls easily into a diagnostic box or a common pattern of health or pathology in life. Simple things. But amongst those thousands and thousands, and maybe over 100,000, there are a few cases that have branded themselves in my memory. They're so peculiar, so strange. They move beyond anything you could comprehend that could happen to a human mind, soul, body. Not many, but I remember those. And of course, in my own life, I've met some pretty strange things too. Maybe it's just because I'm strange. I like strange things. I'm interested in what happens at the margins of life, margins of consciousness even. So tonight, I want to share with you two of the most interesting case histories I have encountered. Human histories, human stories. The names of the men are well enough known, but the complexities of their struggles with visionary events are little understood. And one might think, hearing some of the details of their stories, that they were just crazy. And you know, when you get to the fringes of things as a physician, when you hear things that don't fit patterns, that is often what happens. I see this a lot in clinical medicine. Crazy story. Must be a crazy patient. Goes in the crazy box, and you move on. Don't do that with the story of Professor Tolkien and Dr. Jung. Let me just give that general introduction. John Ronald Reuel Tolkien was born in 1892. He died in 1973. He was a professor, a brilliant, distinguished professor of Anglo-Saxon language at Oxford University, where he also studied as an undergraduate. But, or should I say, and of course, he is also the best-selling author of the 20th century. He's making a big dent on the 21st as well right now. There are more than 250 million copies, I read, or note on Wikipedia, of the Lord of the Rings in print. Not quite as many more of his little story, The Hobbit. And, of course, the cinematic rendition of his masterwork, The Lord of the Rings, has been seen by untold millions, hundreds of millions, and perhaps even a billion people. Carl Gustav Jung was 17 years older than Tolkien. He was born in 1875. He died about 12 years before Tolkien in 1961. He was a physician. He was a professor at university in Zurich as well. And he's known as a psychiatrist, or an alienist, as they used to call them. I love that word, an alienist. They don't say that so much anymore, but it seems quite appropriate for a psychiatrist. He's perhaps less well known in popular culture, but certainly he's had a major influence upon the intellectual culture of the 20th century. And when his red book, a book he crafted, worked on for 16 years around the middle of his life, was finally published after being sequestered and unseen for over, 80 years, it quickly sold 100,000 copies. Well, that's no match for Tolkien, but then The Lord of the Rings doesn't cost $150 a copy either. Interesting cases. Which is why I've spent a couple decades or more investigating the histories of these two men. Probably more like 3 decades with Jung and maybe a couple decades with Tolkien. Repeatedly listening to what they wrote and said, digging out the details, examining the private and primary accounts they left behind, and trying to comprehend what happened to the consciousness of these two men. And based on that study, it's apparent to me and to some others that at a seminal point in their lives, they each had an extended visionary engagement, an engagement with an imaginal realm, which they considered objectively real. They both struggled throughout the rest of their lives to record and to interpret those experiences. Both stories, these histories, have something to tell us about the expanse of consciousness. They present paradigmatic cases that expose a rare realm of human cognition, consciousness, experience, or maybe more broadly stated, what it is to be human, human life. A study of their primary experiences and their parallel hermeneutics of those experiences opens new paths for understanding, creative experience, and the mystery of human consciousness. So let me start by giving you a little bit of an overview of what I see as parallels between Jung and Tolkien. Talk about those strange words, vision and hermeneutics. And then, with that out of the way, let me tell you some strange stories. Beginning in the years around the First World War, both John Ronald Reuel Tolkien and Carl Gustav Jung were summoned by their own unique natures and inclinations to take an exceedingly difficult journey of exploration. Both experienced it and described it as a journey of discovery into unknown realms. But it was not a journey taken in terms of time or temporal space. It was a passage across the quotidian borders of reality into the atemporal realm of imagination. Jung and Tolkien each ventured into a world revealed by vision, or imagination, or fantasy. And each man employed all of those terms to describe what had happened to them. There, however one defines the visionary there, they met a reality, an independent, autonomous, objective fact. And it, there, had a story to tell. They both felt they had discovered something precious, something vital, alive, something of signal importance, something they needed to share with the people of their time. And each man kept private accounts of his experiences, records of what he had seen and heard in his interactions with the imaginal. Both men labored for decades with meticulously crafted primary manuscript accounts of this experience. And strangely enough, as we've heard, both men ended up calling the records of what they brought back from their explorations of the imaginal their Red Book. During life, neither man finished or published his full record, his full account. Dr. Jung and Professor Tolkien recognized that their experiences were far from ordinary. What had happened to them was so strange, so rare, so non-ordinary, that they struggled throughout their lives to find a way of explaining it. What words could one use to explain the reality of an imaginal world opened by vision, to vision, in vision? They toiled trying to find a way of revealing, or at least interpreting their observations to others. They both searched the annals of history for accounts of similar events, paradigms that might indicate similar experience. And by the end of their lives, neither man felt he had succeeded in his efforts to have his experience understood. Nonetheless, both Tolkien and Jung affirmed in unequivocal statements that what they had discovered was indeed a living fact, a substrata of consciousness, or an inherent natural function of consciousness, a province of experience intimately involved in life and in the story we call human history. It was, they both declared, the spring of a creative power that moved and transformed history. How does one understand such experiences, such affirmations, such human lives? How did they understand themselves? How will we interpret them? Those are the basic issues I've been dealing with, the questions I've been asking myself for many years. Jung and Tolkien and the hermeneutics of vision. Strange title. I love it. The hermeneutics of vision. Vision and hermeneutics. Let's start with vision. Language is rooted in human experience. The history of words harbors a chronicle of experience. And, of course, vision is a word with a legacy. According to the Oxford English Dictionary, which Professor Tolkien helped write during his early career, at least small sections of it, in the English language, as evidenced in Middle English reaching back to the 3rd century and then on through at least the Enlightenment period, in usages, the word vision predominantly meant, and I quote here from the OED, something which is apparently seen otherwise than by ordinary sight, especially an appearance of a prophetic or mystical character, or having the nature of a revelation, supernaturally presented to the mind, either in sleep or in an abnormal state. The action or fact of seeing or contemplating something not actually present to the eye. Of course, we do look out through the eye's window at a physical world and meld things seen with our conscious perception. And that is what vision now, of course, most commonly means. Looking out through the eye and seeing physical reality. But when our attention turns and we look in, what are we seeing? What are we envisioning? How do we interpret a vision? Something which is apparently seen other than by ordinary sight. Do we simply deny it any relevance to life? Call it meaningless declare it a sensory aberration? Are things seen within with the second sight, in vision, merely phantom shadows of outward reality? Do we pathologize this experience if we allow it happens? Do we call it an illness of the mind or the brain? A disorder of perception of reality mediated by some natural and recurrent aberrancy of neural tissue. And here I say natural and recurrent because it does appear to be a fact of human nature. And over millennia, it does seem to be recurrent. Well, look, as a doctor, I know about the pathology of hallucination. I mean, if you later tonight have a vision that you've been called, and the vision involves stripping off your clothing and walking through Union Square on your new journey, men in white coats won't come and put you in a padded van and take you to the funny farm. Men in blue with Glock 45s on their belts will come and put you in handcuffs and bring you to see me in an emergency room. Look, I've been doing this for a long time. I've met people in the midst of hallucination, psychosis, pathological vision states. In fact, it's something that I see pretty darn common. And, you know, I've heard some pretty interesting stories. If I have time, sometimes I just sit down out of complete interest trying to find out what is going on in that human head. It's really interesting. Sometimes I can't help, but I do enjoy listening. Well, I can help. I can medicate, right? I can do away with the visions if they're pathological. But I've also heard private and detailed accounts from individuals who are most certainly not crazy about extraordinary events, visions they have had, visions of places, persons, and dialogic encounters. Visions that quite unexpectedly obtruded into consciousness. It happens. And I assure you that some of these events, in fact, in general, these events are among the most important events in the lives of these people. I've been in close contact, maybe I keep strange company, with people who have been through this. And these sometimes are the signal and orienting event in their lives. Not necessarily recurrent or continual, but signal events. And I know a little bit about that. So we have to step back from the pathologizing and find that special domain of vision that I'm speaking about here. And I should also add, when these events happen, people often relate them in religious or spiritual traditional formats. Because where else do you have a language, a hermeneutics, for this event? And sometimes that really takes it right in to craziness, to declaring yourself the prophet in Union Square. Okay, this other word, this strange word, hermeneutics. How does one interpret vision? Hermeneutics is the art of interpretation. The art of moving meaning between domains of expression and understanding. Historically, the term was often linked with the Greek god Hermes, who was the one who brought messages from gods to men. The one who went betwixt realms, worlds, realities, communicating, translating. It is the art of Hermes. In Western tradition, the hermeneutic art originally centered on in the interpretation of sacred writ, on how one should interpret prophetic, visionary, biblical texts. Were these texts to be read as accurate and precise histories of real events, perhaps histories with a moral? Or were they to be read allegorically, Was there something else hidden in them, some other intention in these supposed sacred and mythic accounts? And then much later, from the early 19th century onward, hermeneutics moved into wider spheres, into methods and the philosophical difficulties of interpreting any text, any creative human act, human work. Tolkien and Jung, in their academic writings published during their lives, both concerned themselves with the hermeneutic art. They both applied their professional approaches to ancient texts and myths. And a couple of times Jung even referred to what he was doing as his hermeneutic method. His psychology was a hermeneutics. But in private, each struggled with interpretive matters at a much more intimate level, an immediate level. Their task began not with an interpretation of a text, their principal life task, but with the interpretation of visionary, imaginative events. Their own experience between two realms. This is a primary hermetic, shall we say, task. One stands between the realms as messenger, trying to interpret what has happened. And I, in my terminology, in my own idiolect, I call this the primary hermeneutic problem. You have a vision. You interpret it. You bring it to sensuous form. Now that is a hermeneutic, an interpretive act. You're not walking with a text, you're working with an event. And if the event is visionary, well, how do you record it? How do you represent that properly? But then there, of course, is the next problem. And Tolkien and Jung both dealt with this. Having brought the visionary experience into some perceptible form, into some composition of word and image, how did one then interpret the resultant thing, the resultant act, interpretive act, the sensuous concretization of vision or fantasy or imagination? What is it? Second level. Was it a revelation? Is this a revelation text? Is it a myth? And secondarily, is that then the source of all myth? Was it art? Was it the font of true art? The great elven art? Or was it just nature? Was it the nature of human beings to sometimes find themselves standing between two realities, linking and interpreting dimensions, one seen inwardly, one seen outwardly? Was this a natural function of consciousness? Even if the function had, as Jung suggested when he was at Oxford in 1938, atrophied in our age. In fact, when he was at Oxford, Tolkien's university in 1938, he really suggested if these things aren't happening to us, it may be that a human function, a natural function, is atrophying in our age. And then, going through that level, those levels, primary and secondary, we come down to a real personal problem. How did one interpret oneself? The one who met and mediated two realities. What was it to live a life with such a commission, such a burden? And both men independently struggled with that as well. It was a tough gig. And not many people understood. The story of how they dealt with these complex issues, and I assure you they both did deal with them, and they consciously dealt with them, could fill a long book, and it might if I ever get the damn thing written. But tonight I can only give you some brief glimpses into this most peculiar tale. Glimpses into two humans struggle with vision and its interpretation. Okay, let's tell stories with that prologue. That's the sort of approach I've been taking to the account I'm going to try to give you now. Primary events, interpretive events, how the person understood themselves in the midst of this matter. Writing in 1950, when Jung was 75 years old, he explained his situation 40 years earlier, at the threshold of the visionary experience that produced his red book. The book he inscribed on its spine with the title, Liber Novus, the new book. And I quote, "The psyche is not of today. Its ancestry goes back many millions of years. Individual consciousness is only the flower and the fruit of a season, sprung from the perennial rhizome beneath the earth. And it would find itself in better accord with the truth if it took the existence of the rhizome into its calculations. For the root matter is the mother of all things." He recounted, looking back to what had happened to him on the threshold of this visionary event, he recounted that his intense study of mythologies, which had taken place 1909, 1910, 1911, when he was about 35 years old, forced him to conclude that without a myth, a human is, quote, "like one uprooted, having no true link either with the past or with the ancestral life which continues within him, or yet with contemporary society." He continued on. "So, I suspected that myth had a meaning, which I was sure to miss if I lived outside it in the haze of my own speculations. I was driven to ask myself in all seriousness, what is the myth you are living?" I found no answer to this question and had to admit that I was not living with a myth or even in a myth. So in the most natural way, I took it upon myself to get to know my myth, and I regarded this as the task of tasks. I simply had to know what unconscious or preconscious myth was forming me, from what rhizome, what root I sprang. Beginning in the fall of 1913, when he was about 38 years old, and continuing over the next several years, he confronted this portentous task of tasks. He later described it as a voyage of discovery to the other pole of the world. Or in other words, the place where the mirror image begins. And he found his myth. He found his rhizome, the root from which he sprang. And more, and more. He met the story of an age at its end and a new epic beginning. A startling myth. He called it my secret knowledge for 40 years. Okay, what happened to you? That stuff I just read, that stuff, people know that. He wrote that, published 1950. The question was, how the hell did he find his myth? Happened during these years. Biographers, and there are many, many biographers, have looked at this period and said Jung had a psychotic break. He was mad. Henry Ellenberger, who wrote The History of the Unconscious, which if any of you are interested in consciousness studies, if that's not on your reading list, put it there. Ellenberger described it more kindly. He called it a creative illness. What the hell is a creative illness? Didn't make that clear. I mean, Jung had one. It was one. It was one of those. Was he ill? I mean, did he need, like, drugs? to fix his illness, creative illness, pathologizing, still. Only since publication of the Red Book in 2009, which publication was accompanied by 1,500 incredible notes by Dr. Sonu Shamdasani, one of the most amazing editorial apparatuses I've ever seen, contextualizing this entire book, giving in outlines of what had happened to Jung and referring into all the vast spectrum of his work. Only until that publication in 2009, or only after, have we really had any idea of what did happen to Jung. At the age of 38 and around 1913, Jung had been a doctor for 13 years. He was a psychiatrist. I should add that he had had an openness to hypnagogic experiences. He'd come from a family where there were people who had had visions, including his maternal grandfather, who was the head of the Swiss Reformed Church in Basel. He was a visionary. His mother had seen spirits walking in the house at night. These are events he was aware of. He was a country boy. He was a farm boy. He lived outside Basel. These things were known in his culture, rural culture. He'd been a psychiatrist in 1913 for 13 years, and for the first nine or so of those, he worked mainly at the Berg-Holsley Hospital in outside of Zurich with psychotic patients. He had heard lots of stories. He had had a brief, really, it was brief, 5 or 6 year misadventure with Freud, years in which he determined that they saw things entirely differently. He had split with Freud, and he was on his own, and he came to the conclusion he didn't know what was going on. As he said, all of my theories, I had to accept that all my theories, all my conceptualizations were wrong. I did not know. That year in October, as he was struggling with these things, many things, October 1913, this was about a year before World War I broke out, he was on a train going to his mother-in-law's house in Schaffhausen, and he had a vision. The train entered a tunnel, and he was looking at a book, and suddenly before his eyes what he saw was a vision. He saw a vast wave of blood covering all of Northern Europe, all the way up to the Alps. And in that sea, in that wave, he saw civilization, bodies, houses, floating, destroyed. He says the vision lasted about an hour. The same thing happened again 2 weeks later when he was on the same journey to visit his mother-in-law. Same tunnel, same thing. The man thought, as a psychiatrist who had worked with psychotic patients for 13 years, and neurotics and just normal people too, that maybe he was doing a schizophrenia, as he called it. Maybe he was threatened with a psychosis. He had had visions. He went searching through all of his own story, trying to remember dreams, trying to figure out how he could understand this, maybe even abort what might be a psychotic event. Finally, he knew he just had to give in. He just had to see what it was that was petitioning him. And so on the night of the 12th of November of 1913, he sat at his desk, he reached in to the drawer, he pulled out a journal that he had not written in for 11 years, and he addressed his soul. It's one of the most heart-rending verses I've read. And it starts, my soul, where are you? It goes on. He was petitioning some contact. And then he determined that he had to just wait and see if he could get a response back. For 25 nights he sat there, trying to turn off outward consciousness. He knew that dreams indicated that there was activity when consciousness was turned off. Could he, in awakeness, remove himself enough from his concentration on the outer realm that this inner thing could show itself? Words started coming, soul words. Words like, look into your depths. Hear the depths. This went on for about 25 days. He had some dreams. He got to a point where he felt like if he could engage a fantasy deeply enough, that maybe a fantasy might lead to more fantasy. And so he told it, the only time he spoke about this stuff publicly, I know about, in 1925, to a private seminar, he told them, what I did is I imagined I was digging a hole. I had a shovel. And I would sit there imaginatively at my desk, I mean, I'm just sitting here, in my mind, closing off the outward world, concentrating on the shovel and the hole I was digging. Dig. 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 Feel the shovel. Look at the dirt. Feel the motion, the muscles moving without them moving. He was sure that a fantasy would lead to more fantasy. Finally, he got to a point, and it opened up. He saw a passage. He thought it was an entry to an old mine. He walked through the passage. There was a withered dwarf. There was a cave. He went into the cave. He heard screeching voices. There was muck on the ground. He walked across the cave. He saw a gem of light. He picked up the gem. He looked in, and through the gem was covering an orifice, a hole. He looked in, and there was this river. And in the river floated by the body of a dead hero, followed by a scarab, followed by a sun deep in the water. And then he saw snakes, thousands and thousands of black snakes come down the walls, surround the sun, and then blood came surging up from the hole. And that was the end of the vision. He told the seminar in 1925 that he discovered that his technique worked amazingly well, but he didn't have the foggiest idea what it meant. That was the beginning of this visionary event. About 12 days later, right around Christmas, I think it was the 22nd or 23rd of December, he entered into another vision. This one was different. This one was not so evoked. It just opened. And I'll read just a little bit here. This is 22 December 1913. And this is what he told the seminar in 25. The next thing that happened to me was another fantastic vision. But this time I went much deeper. This time it was a cosmic depth. It was like going to the moon, or like the feeling of descent into empty space. In his Red Book, in Liber Novus, he recounts the vision. Here I quote from the Red Book. I lay, and this is his account. This is a primary hermeneutic, right? This is his recension of what he saw, what happened to him, as he wrote it. I lay in a dark depth. An old man stood before me. He looked like one of the old prophets. A black serpent lay at his feet. Some distance away, I saw a house with columns. A beautiful maiden stepped out of the door. She walks uncertainly, and I see that she is blind. The old man waves to me. I follow him to the house at the front of a sheer rock wall. The serpent creeps behind. Suddenly a door opens on the right, onto a garden full of bright sunshine. We step outside, and the old man says to me, "Do you know where you are?" Jung replies, "I am a stranger here, and everything seems strange to me, anxious as in a dream. Who are you?" And the man answers, "I am Elijah, and this is my daughter, Salome." It goes on. It goes on. And it went on, actually, night after night for three nights. Jung called this his mystery play, his mysterium. At the conclusion of the first night's vision, Jung exclaims to Salome and Elijah, quote, "You are the symbols of the most extreme contradiction." Elijah responds, "We are real. We are not symbols." Several years later, Jung penned a psychological reflection on this stuff. 10 years later, private, once again, unpublished, trying to figure out, talk about who these figures were. And he said they're certainly not intended allegories. They have not been consciously contrived to depict experience in either veiled or fantastic terms. Rather, they appeared as visions. He called it his mystery play. Later on, Tolkien described this sort of experience as entering a Faerian drama. And we'll get to that quote in a little while. Just remember that. Entering a Faerian drama, the mystery play. For the next 2 months, Jung voluntarily entered into these depths almost nightly. And I should here step back and say, at the same time, the man was continuing his medical practice. He was seeing on average 5 patients a day during this period. He was lecturing. He was teaching. He was not psychotic. He was continuing a normal life. He was serving in the Swiss Army during subsequent periods quite, frequently. He wasn't sitting in a corner with drool coming down his face, lost in a psychotic event. But they didn't keep going forever. The intensity of these events really went from December on through February. They slowed down a little bit less by April, and then it really pretty much stopped by June. But he would go in the evenings, usually after dinner, and sit and try to evoke these things, enter into them. Some of the stuff is really funny. It's farcical. Some of it is absolutely frightening. That's what the Red Book is. These events in that period of time, this short period of a few months, really is the core of what Jung talked about in Liber Notus, the Red Book. In his commentary on this material, which he wrote, this is the primary hermeneutic. Then he started doing the interpretation of what this had happened. And 9 months later, he started trying to figure this out. And this is what he said, trying to explain what had happened. He said, "If you remain within the arbitrary and artificially created boundaries, you will walk as between two high walls. You do not see the immensity of the world. But if you break down the walls that confine your view, then the ancient sleeper awakens in you. If you look outside yourself, you see the far-off forest and mountains, and above them, your vision climbs to the realms of the stars. And if you look into yourselves, you will see, on the other hand, the nearby as far off and infinite, since the world of the inner is as infinite as the world of the outer. Man lives in two worlds." He spoke of what he was doing, this primary hermeneutic, this trying to record the visions. And in the very introduction of the Red Book, he says this, speaking about, his attempt to express what had happened. And he says, "My speech is imperfect, not because I want to shine with words, but out of the impossibility of finding those words. I speak in images. With nothing else can I express the words from the depths. I speak in images. With nothing else can I express the words from the depth." But at this point, I should add, there were no illustrations. This was his manuscript he wrote this in. The words themselves, the phrasing, the way he expressed himself was an image. Later, as he composed the Red Book, as he transcribed this into his book, he wrote this, let me just explain that. So he thought he was going crazy, except he wasn't. He wasn't crazy. These visions had come. He didn't know what it was about. Throughout this period, he had had several, many visions of the coming of a great devastation, a war, death. And then in August of 1914, the First World War broke loose. And he saw at that moment that what he had been through actually was part of a cultural moment, a human moment. That what was happening in him was an expression, perhaps even revelatory, precognitive, of events that were about to transform his land, his continent, his world. And it was at that point that he decided that this was an important work, that he had to do something with it. He wrote the manuscript. He wrote the commentary over the next months in 1914 to early 1915, and then he spent 16 years trying to transcribe this material into his big red book with art, with imagery added to the image of his words. 16 years. And during all this period, he was also doing something else. He was looking for those who might have shared a similar experience. Paradigmatic cases. Anything to indicate that what he had quite clearly experienced, this visionary realm, was a human experience, and that there are records that he could use to relate what had happened to him. By the early 1920s, he wrote this book to others. He thought he would publish it. It was only by the early 1920s he realized it was absolutely impossible. There were people around him who thought he should publish it, and he saw it was impossible, that no one would understand this. No one could understand what had happened to him. And it was at that point he really slowed down and then ended his transcription, his attempt at the art of the Red Book. He worked 16 years and did not finish it. He only entered about two-thirds of the manuscript material he had composed into the artistic, calligraphic, illustrated big Red Book, Liber Novus, the new book. Then he went on to what I would call a secondary hermeneutics. He had to develop a way of approaching such events in history, in his history, in human history. He thought it was vital to do so. And he spent the rest of his life working on that hermeneutics, that interpretive act of bringing people into an understanding of such events in history, looking for the paradigmatic cases, and he laid out a number of them. He was a historian, a physician who was an historian looking for the history of this experience. And if you read his collected writings, I mean, the Yoga Sutras of Patanjali, the meditations of Ignatius of Loyola, Meister Eckhart, these are all the texts. Kundalini, these were the things he was studying and looking at, trying to understand what had happened to him. And at the very beginning of his looking, he thought he had found an analog of his experience in the ancient writings of the Gnostics, heretics, so-called, visionaries, creating new myths at the beginning of the Christian age. Jung published several million words in his secondary hermeneutics without ever revealing the source. At the end of life, he spoke of these events as the numinous beginning, which contained everything. Everything, he says, began then. Everything else was the scientific elaboration, the bringing into life, but the numinous beginning was then. Well, of course, for the last, I mean, Jung's been dead now for 50 years, and Jung's scholarship has been devoid of any knowledge of this material, any way of contextualizing the source of his work. It's turned into a clinical specialty where the man's vision, the man's work was much, much broader than a clinical, therapeutic specialty. He was looking at what it was to be human. Dr. Sonu Shamdasani introduced the Red Book at the Library of Congress in 2010. They had a big museum show there and a conference. And Sonu gave an amazing talk. And again, it's one of those things you can't find on YouTube if you go looking. And Sonu talked about Jung's approach to Blake and Swedenborg, visionaries, and compared Jung's approach to these individuals, what he'd said about them. And then he concluded with these words. This is what Dr. Shamdasani said. Quote, "If, as Jung claimed, Dante and Blake clothed visionary experience in mythological forms, could we not pose the question, did Jung in turn attempt to clothe visionary experience in conceptual, psychological forms? If so, the power and significance of his work does not reside in his concepts, which are familiar to us, but in the visionary experience which was at the back of them." End quote. Dr. Shamdasani is the Philemon Professor of Jung History at the University College London. He's in his mid-50s now. He is certainly the most knowledgeable historian of Jung I know. He spent more than half his life involved in this stuff. He spent now 20 years working on the Red Book, Jung's diaries from this period, his collected writings thereafter. What was the man's conclusion? The power and significance of his work does not reside in his concepts, which are familiar to us, but in the visionary experience, which was at the back of them. The visionary experience, the primary experience, and the primary hermeneutic, as opposed to the secondary elaborations. Professor John Ronald Reuel Tolkien. One of the most common questions I asked by fans of Tolkien and by people involved in Tolkien studies is, did Tolkien believe in elves? And I've been asked that question a few times. People know of my interests. And I have an answer. No. Tolkien did not believe in elves. Tolkien knew elves. He had met many. He knew their names. He knew their stories. He knew their sorrows. He knew their elven art. And the question that usually follows up to that is, what you're saying then is, Tolkien was crazy? And you see, that's the box. Where do you put this experience? And that's why I think, you know, when you have paradigmatic cases, you need more than one. Otherwise, it's what I call the chop suey problem. It's the sui generis. It's just one of a kind. Well, what kind is it? It's that one kind. You need to bring things into context, into that transdisciplinary dialogue. You need to look at these human experiences side by side before you can start contextualizing. My gosh, it's not just the one of a kind, it is the human kind. Does that make sense? And that's why I found it so critically important to look at these two figures and their approaches together. And believe me, I'm not trying to force this stuff together. That doesn't work. You can't do that as a scholar validly. I mean, people do it, but I've really tried to see, does it fit? And I conclude it does. So what happened to Jung? Excuse me, I do this quite often. What happened to Tolkien? Change channels here. So what happened to John Reuel, Ronald Reuel? And what was his hermeneutics of vision? And here I'm going to abbreviate. It's painful for me to abbreviate. I'm going to exercise infinite compassion, or at least focused compassion tonight, and abbreviate. Tolkien had some interesting experiences as a young man too. Some people are more visual, as Tolkien wrote in later life, with their visionary experience. Some are more auditory. Jung said exactly the same thing in a long essay. And early in life, Tolkien really had an amazing sense of language. When he discovered as a young teenager the language Anglo-Saxon, he felt he actually already knew it. It came to him just quite naturally. In those same early years, maybe later teenage years, he started experiencing what he called his ghost words. Ghost, well, Tolkien was interested in words. He was a philologist by profession. The word goes all the way back into Indo-European roots. It's in Sanskrit as well. Ghost, it means a spirit, a soul, a spirit world word, a ghost soul word. And these words would come to him. They'd come to him fully formed, and they'd come to him with meaning. He explained later on that most frequently they came as nouns, but there were adjectives, fewer verbs that would come. Earendil, Ainur, Valar, Iluvitar, Melkor, Varda, Silmaril, Elbareth, Gilfoniel, Luthien, Tenubiel. Words. And he imagined this was, in some unknowable manner, an echo of his own original language. He kept a notebook with him in later years. When these words would come obtruding into consciousness, he'd write them down, he'd write down the meanings, and then as a philologist, he'd try to figure them out. Figure out what other words are related to them, how they evolved. And the words evolved into complex languages. And then Tolkien became convinced that language was related to a mythology. That languages were formed in mythologies, meanings were involved and related to mythologies. The languages brought him stories. I think it was in 1913 or 1914. He was walking on the Cornish coast, stormy seacoast of England, and a name came to him. Eärendil. It seemed significant in immense ways. He went home and he wrote a poem about it. A fragment. It was a mythic image of Eärendil, the one who had sailed across the Western Sea into the sky. And he knew it was part of something. He sent the poem to a friend, one of his dear school friends, and the friend wrote him back a letter. He says, well, you know, that's really very interesting. But what's it about? And Tolkien's response was, I don't know. I'll have to find out. Not, I will have to create something. Gosh, I'll have to make up the rest of that story, won't I? I'll have to find out. Tolkien spent the next 40 years of his life finding out. This figure remains a key in his mythology for decades. Many things opened up in this time, and and Becca's talk covered some of this stuff very well. And also, I have about 5 hours of Tolkien lectures online, which are illustrated. I have some of the illustrations of things he was doing during this period. If you're interested in this, go look in there. You can find more. By 1915, after he had graduated from Oxford, he was deeply in love, he married, and he got sent to war. In July 1st, Lieutenant Tolkien was at the Somme, at the beginning of the Battle of the Somme, the most horrendous sacrifice of the First World War. In the first day of the battle, 20,000 British soldiers died. Over the next 4 months of the battle, there were over 1 million casualties, over 250,000 dead, although the exact number is not really known. And they were dead and lying, wounded over 500 or 600 meters of French mud. Tolkien saw it all. He was a signal officer. He was at the fronts trying to communicate the carnage at the front to the commanding officers at the back. He witnessed it. Two of his three best friends died at the Somme. Tolkien, at the end of October, realized the battle was winding down, almost over, became ill. He started developing high fevers. He was diagnosed as having trench fever, which was an unknown disease, marked by high fevers and aching joints. It was thought to be, now we think it was probably conveyed by something carried by the lice in the trenches, of which all the men were infested. And he was sent home to England, to hospital. At that moment, the Elven mythologies really opened up. He began writing. He had a little school notebook, and in December, while he was in hospital, he started writing the first of his Elven stories. They're called the Lost Tales. They're not complete stories. They're not literary works. They're condensations of things that were working on him. But some of those tales stuck with him. They were foundational to everything he did thereafter. One was the story of Beren and Lúthien, Tuviel. A man who fell in love with an elven princess. And to win her hand, had to win back a stolen gem of light. A gem stolen by a force of evil in this world. You know, I'll just say this in passing. People have said, well, maybe Tolkien had PTSD. Well, I've been a physician working in a Veterans Administration hospital now for, not all the time, part-time. I work there part-time as a professor, taking care of people with PTSD now for 20 years. I've seen people with PTSD from World War II onward, through all those conflicts. And believe me, I'm seeing a great deal of it right now. This wasn't PTSD. I know what that is. I see that. This may have been a therapeutic move for Tolkien, but it was not a manifestation of a disorder. Maybe it was his therapeutic move. Then something extraordinary happened. In 1919, Jung wrote a cosmogonic myth. What's a cosmogonic myth? It's like a story of the coming to consciousness, the coming to being, the coming to reality of a world, of us. You don't run into these very often. I should add, in 1916, Jung did exactly the same thing. He also wrote an amazing cosmogonic myth. These are the sources of religions, the key texts of religious movements. And I must say, he called it the Einrindale, the music of the gods. And I've read this myth again and again, and I must tell you, and I can't go into any of the details here, I know of only one myth in history that coincides with this myth, and that is the Manichaean myth, the myth of the prophet Mani. And I'll say no more than that other than send you looking if you want to go looking. Speaking of the stuff that was happening much later, he wrote in letters, he said, of these things, they arose in my mind as given things. As they came separately too, so the links grew, an absorbing, though continually interrupted, labor. Yet always I had the sense of recording what was already there, somewhere. Not of inventing. Not of inventing. And what did you think he was doing in those early years? He explained years later what he was doing. I had a mind to make a body of more or less connected legend, running from the large and cosmogonic to the level of the romantic fairy tale, which I would dedicate simply to England, to my country. In another letter, this is 1950, in another letter, 1956, he said that the venture he had undertaken was to precisely to restore to England an epic tradition and present them with a mythology of their own. He was trying to create a mythology. Jung, remember mythology? Finding a mythology, living, needing a mythology. He felt England needed a mythology. But what's a mythology? Isn't that a given thing? Received from past, from history, from peoples, from ancient times, from ancient superstitions. Aren't myths sort of canonical? Tolkien was trying to fracture canon, fracture the sense of a canon of myth, a new myth for a new time, for his people. This is what that young man, back from the war, writing those myths, moving on for the next 20 years writing, was thinking. He worked into the night on these things. I mean, Tolkien was a busy man. He had a full professorial schedule. He taught a full set of lectures. He was a don at the university. He had all these damn department meetings and things to go to, and all the administrative affairs, which some of you probably take doing with great joy, but Tolkien didn't. He was doing this stuff. And then he would sit at night, late into the night, doing this his mythological work. And he didn't know what he was doing. What was this hermeneutic? He tried writing this stuff in the form of fairy stories. Simple. He tried doing it in poetry, couplets, in alliterative verse. He wrote some of this stuff in Anglo-Saxon. He did some of it in Elven. What was the hermeneutic? What was the appropriate voice for conveying what he had been doing? And he had no intention, no thought that he could get it published. Then, of course, in 1937, a children's story, a story he told his children, ends up in the hands of a publisher, gets published in The Hobbit, is a hit in England. First printing, 3,000 copies, is selling. And all of a sudden, Tolkien is known for that. It was embarrassing, in a way. He says that people at Oxford used to rouse him, you know, Professor, how is your Hobbit doing? You know, the professor of Anglo-Saxon literature known for his Hobbit story. Well, and it was at this point, I mean, Tolkien had worked on this, what I call that secondary hermeneutic, sort of trying to describe what it is you have been doing. He had done this with his lecture on Beowulf at the British Academy in 1936, and he went now, he received an invitation to St. Andrews to give a lecture, the Andrew Lang lecture. And he determined he was going to talk about what he'd been doing. He called the lecture on fairy stories. But you know what? He wasn't interested in talking about fairy stories. He started out his entire lecture by saying, you know, what people call fairy stories, they aren't fairy stories. That's not what I'm talking about. He wanted to talk about fairy, the experience of the imaginal. And so in the first part of his lecture, he just moves away from all that stuff. The lecture was written in 39. I mean, this is details you don't need to know, but I'll tell you anyway, because that's what I do. We don't have the text of the original lecture. But over the next 3 years, he worked on a draft manuscript of the final published edition. And he published it. And he cut out the best parts. There were things he said as he was authoring this material that was really self-revelatory. But when he finally got to the final text, he cut this stuff out. It was unknown for years and years and years. Finally, it was published just a few years ago of his draft manuscripts. Verlin Flieger and I think Anderson went through, and they edited all this stuff out. And the stuff he said is amazing. The stuff he was afraid to say in public. And it's really, it's a key text. There's another key text that I can't get through tonight, but this is a key text. He started the draft introduction, the one he didn't use. And he said, the land of faery is wide and deep and high. In that land, a man may perhaps count himself fortunate to have wandered. But its very mystery and wealth make dumb the traveler who would report. The fairy gold too often turns to withered leaves when it is brought away. All that I can ask is that you will receive my withered leaves, as a token at least that my hand once held a little fairy gold. That my hand once held a little fairy gold. Well, he cut that out. But I love that line, because you know what Jung said about his early experiences? Let me just read you. This is what Jung wrote in his end of his life about his early experiences. He said, I felt that at some time or the other I had passed through the Valley of Diamonds, that I could convince no one that the specimens I brought back were more than pieces of gravel. You see that parallel? You've been there. What you bring back. How difficult it is to interpret. Well, let me just read you some excerpts. This is the material where, you see, Tolkien has done this primary stuff. He's done the recension of his myths for years. Now he's talking about what I've done. I just have a few more minutes to go through this stuff. So he asked, what is fairy? What is fairy? And once again, he's not talking about fairy stories. Fairy would be equivalent to what Jung would call the collective unconscious. The realm, archetypal realm, imaginative realm. So he says, what is fairy? It reposes in a view that the normal world, tangible, visible, audible, is only an appearance. Behind it is a reservoir of power, which is manifest in these forms. If we can drive a well down to this reservoir, we shall tap a power that can not only change the visible forms of things already existent, but sprout up with a boundless wealth forms of things never before known, potential but unrealized. Later in the notes, he puts in this other thing. He starts talking about this fairian drama. He said the difficult task was to enter this fairy realm and see it. And see it, and he quotes, in action and being as we see our objective world, with the mind free from the limited body. A fairian drama. To see it as we see our objective world. You see that immediacy of vision. To enter a fairian drama, free mind. And he says something else, and this is exactly like Jung. He says, an essential power of fairy, is thus the power of making immediately effective, by will, the visions of fantasy. Visions of fantasy. Effective, by will, the visions of fantasy. This is exactly what Jung was trying to do in 1913 and 1914 winter. Make effective, by will, visions. Tolkien goes on further in an attempt to describe what it was like to be in a Faerian drama. And he goes on, he says, Faerian drama. Those plays which, according to abundant records, the elves have often presented to men can produce a fantasy, with a realism and immediacy beyond the compass of any human mechanism. As a result, their usual effect upon a man is to go beyond belief. If you are present at a Faerian drama, you yourself are, or think you are, bodily inside its world. The experience may be very similar to dreaming, but in Faerian drama, you are in a dream that some other mind is weaving. And the knowledge of that alarming fact may slip from your grasp. I believe Tolkien was talking about something he had experienced. You think you are there. And this is, of course, again, this is a description of what Jung was talking about in his own annals of experience. Did Tolkien know elves? The question, what did he mean by Faerian drama? This is the stuff that has been tossed around in Tolkien studies for the last few decades, and very little understood, as Becca quite correctly said in her introduction. But in the last issue of Tolkien Studies, it's an annual, the 2014 edition came out last fall, Verlin Flieger, perhaps one of the best known and perhaps one of the best Tolkien scholars. She's been a professor at the University of Maryland. She's now, I believe, in her 80s. I think she's retired from her professorship. She is the one who edited the notes, the draft material on fairy stories that I was just reading from. She's been all through the archives at the Bodleian at Oxford. An amazing scholar and a cautious scholar. But from the very beginning of her books, it was clear that she saw something about Tolkien that others weren't. And she finally did it. She finally said it. She wrote a paper called What Did He Really Mean? And in that paper, which if you're interested in Tolkien studies, you should look at, what she said is he meant what he said. He said lots of things, but when he said this stuff about elves, about visions, he meant it. It had happened. Oh, she's a cautious scholar, you know, she's a little soft on the edges of some of those affirmations. But then she gives this final quote. It's well known to most Tolkien scholars. It was written by a woman who knew him well, who worked on translations from Middle English with him. A longtime partner. And she gives this quote, written by this friend of Tolkien's. I said to him once, you broke the veil, didn't you? And passed through. Which in fact he did, and which he readily admitted. No wonder, therefore, that he could recapture the language of the fairies. You broke the veil and passed through, which he readily admitted. Passed through. What does that mean? Consider his comment. The power of making effective by will the vision of fantasy. Perhaps that is what he meant. Just in closing, in summary, okay, visions, myths, stories, good reading, if you like that sort of reading, interesting lives, paradigmatic. Is there more? A message. Now here, well, here one starts working with his own vision, his own intuition, his own sense of life. There was something that Jung found in the Red Book that he called his secret knowledge. It's clearly present in the visions and in his commentary on the visions written for his Liber Novus, his Red Book. And I wrote a long paper on this that you can find online called Jung and Ion, if you want to go looking for it. Jung had seen in his visions not only the coming of a war, but the coming to an end of an age. He felt that we had actually lost our myths. That a new myth of consciousness, a new myth of what it was to be human, maybe what might be called a new type of God story, was about to begin taking formation. He saw that in human consciousness there had been major ages. He called them ions, periods of thousands of years, reaching back 6,000 years. The Christian age, the third age, was coming to an end. We were at a time of catastrophic danger. If we did not face the fact of the imaginal, of the vision, which is our nature, of the stories in us which in this age are trying to come to the surface, be known, be heard, be found, be written, and perhaps be interpreted, we were in trouble. Late in life, he said, the world hangs by a thread, and that thread is the psyche, the soul, and its imaginal words, languages, forms, myths. And you know, Professor Tolkien worked on his mythology for 40 years. It grew from foundation in layers through ages to a third age. This book that has sold 250 million copies, been made into movies, seen by untold hundreds of millions of people, is about the end of an age. A task, a conflict. My intuition is that these imaginal stories have meaning. It's been suggested to me, and I've thought it myself, that if we do indeed survive for 500 years and look back at this age, asking from that perspective far away what our myths were, what were the foundational myths, what were the important stories we told, what were our religious stories, I thought that the Red Book of Jung and Tolkien may be on the list of foundational mythologies of a new human consciousness. Maybe that's a prophecy, and maybe not. It is my intuition. Give it some thought. This is an interesting subject. These men deserve our attention. At the doorway of Shelob's lair in The Lord of the Rings, Sam realized that the story he was in was a very old story. It went all the way back to Beren and Lúthien, the story that, well, a Tolkien first heard after the Great War. And he looked at Frodo and he said, "Don't the great tales never end?" "No, they never end as tales," said Frodo. "But the people in them, the people in them come and go when their parts ended. We have our part in the tale now being told. Tolkien and Jung did as well. We shall see where it goes. I thank you very much for your attention, and I will open it for any questions. Any questions? Any comments? I've worn you out. Please.
Yeah, I guess an obvious one is about the gradations within various interpreted contextualized experiences. With imaginal realms, you mentioned words like psychotic and pathologies, and it seems also a question of containership within the interpretive mediums you were discussing, because maybe what is safe at one moment for an individual to be in an experience and feel is real for them, maybe it's not safe in another context. So I'd be curious about playing with that duality we still tend to separate.
Wow. Yeah. That's really a core question, because it has to do with, creative illness versus pathology versus psychosis, doesn't it? You know, what is the protected realm? What is the safe realm? Let me just give you my experience from dealing with people. When this stuff happens, people think they're crazy. And they go looking for contexts. And it can drive people over the edge. If they can find a context or a contextualization for what's happening to them, it gives them space. It gives them a safer space. And you know what? That's one of the reasons I'm standing up here talking to you about this stuff, is to give our age contextualizations. As I look at a room of people, as many as are here, I suspect some of you had experiences like this, and you probably didn't have a context for them. We need contexts other than I am the new prophet, or I'm psychotic. Jung really was a psychiatrist and was troubled. So I'm not suggesting that these are easy events to tolerate. When Tolkien came back from the Great War, he was writing these myths. He was in hospital with men who had PTSD, men who had shell shock, as it was known, men who were wounded seriously in mind and body all around him. And he was doing his mythology, writing these tales at that time. And maybe that was his therapy. So I don't know that a person should go looking for this stuff. And then I would also step back and add that Tolkien, at the end of his life, said some things which would indicate that he felt an experience such as he had had of that depth and magnitude only happens once in a generation. And Jung felt somewhat the same. There are levels of this stuff which are really rare. And the ability of a human being to endure it and deal with it and not be driven mad. And this is, if you look at Jung's work, when he went back looking at examples of people who had been through this, a lot of them were pretty much over the edge. He was trying not to go over the edge. So I'm not suggesting to you that it's not dangerous. It might be. But in some way we have to contextualize it and bring it in to a wider dialogue of non-pathology in some cases.
How to ask this, but I've been curious about it for a while. Do you think, it seems like if Jung and Tolkien had met and been able to talk to each other and support each other through all that, and yet they didn't.
This is,
and I'm wondering why, but not the logistical why, but the big why.
As a matter of fact, and this is something I want to talk about. I'm glad you asked the question. Tolkien did know a good deal about Jung. Now, and in fact, he had what I think may have been imaginal conversations with Jung that he wrote down. So I've asked this question, obviously, myself. It's like, what sort of a conversation would these guys have had? Now, Tolkien was younger, Jung older, his experiences that took different forms and went over a different period of time. But Tolkien was a don at Oxford in 1930, and he was a Roman Catholic. He was part of the Roman Catholic community at Oxford, which was not very large. At Oxford, there was a group called the Blackfriars. It's the priory of the Dominicans. There were three, this is details, but there were three Catholic fathers in the priory at Blackfriars who were extremely interested in Jung. One of them was in analysis during the 1940s when Jung was writing on, when Tolkien was writing on fairy tales. Tolkien said Mass at Blackfriars. He has served in Mass, helped the priest in Mass. He knew all of these guys. One of them was in correspondence with Jung in 1937. And Jung wrote him and said, when I come to Oxford in 38, I want to meet with you at Blackfriars. Jung received an honorary doctorate of six or eight were given at Oxford that summer, Trinity term, in 1938. Jung was one. Tolkien was almost certainly at that ceremony. It's a big ceremonial. Father Victor White became a very good one of the Dominicans at Blackfriars, was in correspondence with Jung after the war. He was in analysis during the 40s, and he actually became a very close friend of Jung's from 46 onward. It is inconceivable that Tolkien didn't know something about Jung. But even more interesting, those notes I just read you from on fairy stories, well, those are notes. And he kept notes of things he wanted to talk about on pages that were reproduced by Verlin Fliegler. One of the things he wrote he wanted to talk about, and she actually reproduced this page in her book, Jung and the collective unconscious. That was on his list of things he wanted to talk about in his paper on fairy stories, which he did not. And then in 1944, when he really almost had a nervous breakdown, he went through this long imaginative dialogue. And a figure shows up in this who is a chemist, or an alchemist and a psychoanalyst. And he's the only person in these dialogues who understands vision and dream and takes them seriously. His name is Dolbear in the story. And if you read through it, it's like, oh my God. He's in analysis with Jung. Imaginative. He's having an imaginative analysis. Well, I shouldn't have. It's a long story, and I would have loved to have given a lecture on that one too, but we can't go there tonight. So I think they would have had a very interesting. I think probably by 44, if Tolkien and Jung could have sat down together, it would have been a damn interesting conversation. Yes, please.
Thank you for your talk.
Thank you.
Really, really nourishing. I'll just ask a question. The idea that everything of Jung's came out of this materia of the Red Book. How do you square that with, for instance, the publication of Psychology of the Unconscious or Symbols of Transformation, where you already have this very clear recognition of the two kinds of thinking, the Ninth Sea Journey, amazing proliferation of mythological motifs and so on. I mean, in a sense, it's all there. I'm not really sure about the original Psychology of the Unconscious as compared with what became Symbols of Transformation.
Yeah, the CW5, the published version, he did rewrite that.
Yeah.
And the original version, you can get that. It's on the internet, actually, and it's much.
It's Bain's translation.
It's a little bit different, yeah. It was actually Beatrice Hinkle was the translator. She was the translator of that. It was published in 1916 under the Psychology of the Unconscious. It's a little bit more primitive. So what I'd say is, Jung was thinking about this stuff a great deal. And obviously he was. But this, if you read the original volume that he wrote in 1912, it is chaotic. The guy is in chaos. And he felt he was in chaos with his material. It's just like this and that and here and there and this myth and that myth and mother myths and, sacrificial myths. It's all there. And that's what I read that quote that he wrote in 1950 to the revised edition of the volume 5. And he says, I was dealing with this stuff, and then I had to figure it out. So I think Jung was working with all this stuff probably from the time he was 4 years old, dealing with it. He had been in a period, what Dr. Shyam Dasani calls a period of self-alienation. And the period of self-alienation started really as he got out of medical school into his psychiatric work in his early relationship with Freud. He was really being alienated, but he was still working with this stuff. And when it got to the fracture point, he had to go back in. So a lot of the concepts were there, but when he starts the Red Book, what he says is, you know, I have to give up with my concepts and I have to go to the original experience. And that's what he did then. So I think that what came after the Red Book period is immensely more complex and deep than the chaos of the first book, 1912. Although he thought that that was his entry point. That was the beginning of his journey. That's when it came clear to him that he had to go.
Maybe like that prodromal dream.
Yeah, it was. That's exactly how he saw it. Yeah. That's a good question. Thank you.
Thank you. I really appreciated this talk. I'm curious. I really loved the way you summed up the part about Jung and how it was his primary experience in becoming the unconscious that was important, not the scientific or psychological concepts he then talked about after.
Yeah.
And I'm curious for us today, you know, this idea of Jung removing his attention and awareness from external reality in order to make space for the unconscious to emerge and form and, mm-hmm. and he can participate in, which is well known within like Eastern traditions of meditation mm-hmm. or imaginative practices. And he did a lot of research in Kundalini. And
yes.
Mm-hmm. I'm curious if you have any thought, I'm not quite as familiar with Tolkien, but for those of us in the West, I know Jung had referred to the importance, similar as I think like the Dalai Lama has, of Westerners maybe the importance of staying within Western traditions, Western myths, Western practices. And I'm curious what you think about those of us encountering these depths, what it means, especially in this new age mixing pot where a lot of people are going to the East and practicing Eastern things, studying the Eastern teachings, what you think about that for folks who are Western and trying to reclaim our own myth and our own practices.
It's what some people need to do. Period. Jung said a lot of the stuff he did. He was negative. He dissuaded Westerners to go into Eastern practices. He felt that it was alien to their psyche, alien to their nature, and there was a great deal of wealth in the Western tradition. The people would get disoriented, and he saw it happen. But at the same time, you have to understand, in the 1920s and 30s, we're talking about Annie Besant and, you know, theosophy, and some of the stuff the stuff that was available was not nearly at the level of what we now have. I mean, the Dalai Lama wasn't going to Zurich in 1930. You weren't having authentic, you know, teachers of these levels coming to the transdisciplinary dialogue. We're in a different stage right now of our cultural interchange. And I think we've matured also culturally, which allows some of those openings to occur in ways that they did not occur for the British neurotic showing up in Zurich in 1928. So I think that if that's where it goes for you, that's where it goes. However, the whole idea of transdisciplinary or of East-West dialogue is critical. So yes, you go. What do you bring? And what do you bring back? What's the interchange? I think we really are growing. And so that you can't just take it one way or the other. You have to really grow these things. And, you know, I've sort of been down that road myself. I've looked at the Christian tradition and the Western tradition pretty deeply. I found a lot in it. A lot of it's been contextualized by my study of Eastern traditions as well. Please.
I love this phrase that you use of Tolkien, you believe in elves, he knew elves, and the thought that came to mind as you were saying that is even the word elf doesn't really convey who it was he encountered,
mm-hmm.
and he struggled with finding the name that translated to these people.
Yeah, I think I know where you're going, yeah.
He initially called them gnomes, coming from gnosis. I think he was probably wise in a way to drop that, because what did you all picture when I said gnomes? And calling them the Noldor is much more elegant. But so through this, I kind of want to draw you out, because you did mention the creation myth, the Adelindale, and its particular relationship to the Gnostic creation.
Yes, okay, well, first, I cut that out of my compassionate abbreviation, which really was not much of an abbreviation tonight. Yeah, when Tolkien was trying to understand these tales that were coming to him and give names to things, the name that first presented itself in 1917, and which he'd used earlier, and it's in his notebooks when he gets back from the war, is that he had gone to visit the gnomes. And linguistically, the gnomes were the Gnostics, the Gnostikoi, the knowers. And he found out that a lot of people thought the gnomes were like a Northern European, lawn ornaments or something. It didn't quite work in his mythology. By the way, if you want to get me something for Christmas, I've wanted a really nice set of gnomes for my lawn. So he changed the name in Nodoli, but in his etymology, in his philological terminology, it still meant the same thing, the knowers. So, and this is all that struck me, since I'm interested in Gnosticism, is that here Jung is, the first place he goes looking for this stuff, and the first place he thinks he finds it is in Gnostic mythology. And here Tolkien is, within 2 years of that, 3 years of that, Tolkien is imaginatively meeting elves who identify themselves to him. He didn't make up this name. Remember, these are ghost names, spirit names. These are names that came to him, not his creations. He discovered. And the name he discovers for these people is the Knowers. Well, that is peculiar, isn't it? And then the myth, the music of the gods, the Ainur, So, he writes this in 1919. We don't know much about when he wrote it, other than he wrote it on the back of some stuff he was working at the Oxford University Press in 1919. And it's just this amazing creation myth. I mean, you can read it in a simple way, but if you actually take the elements and put them together, it is amazing. And I said it was like the Manichaean myth. Buy me a drink, and give me about 2 hours, and we'll talk about that. It's first of all, to explain what I mean by that, I have to explain who Mani was, what Manichaeans were, what Manichaean mythology is like, what the intricacies of Manichaean mythology are like, what the sources of Manichaean mythology are like, what the central myth is, and then you have to say, well, what are the Ainur Lindale like? What are the Ainur? And then start. But if you do that, I don't know if I can do that in 2 hours, especially after a scotch, but if you do that, and I've done it, you come away like, whoa, what a myth. What a myth. And it is a cosmogonic myth. This myth, as Christopher Tolkien said of his father's mythology, there are a couple things that came very early that really never changed throughout his entire mythology, and this cosmogonic myth, the Ainur Lindale, or the music of the Ainur, music of the gods, never changed. It was a foundation. Cosmogonic myths are foundations of mythologies, and this was the foundation of his mythology. How he equated this with his Roman Catholicism is quite a mystery, but so it goes. I guess, the gnomes told him, what are you going to do? I mean, that's what they said, what are you going to do? Are we done? Ladies and gentlemen, thanks. It was really fun being with you. Good night.